In this session, we are about to learn on how to install Max ERP software. To install the software, first we'll download the Max ERP setup file from the website, and either from a CD or any USB drive if you have. And we'll just copy that in the system, and we'll just right click and give run as administrator. Once we click this, it'll ask us the directory in which it has to be installed. So while we install Max ERP, you just have to click next. Is asking whether you want to install in D drive Max ERP.
Okay.
For now, I'll just change it to E drive. Default, it will not be installed in C drive because C drive usually will have Windows. So we try avoiding installing the software in C drive. Unless the system has only one drive, means there's no other option left. Otherwise, we generally install software in D drive or any other drive where Windows is not available. And then we click next. The second option it says is install application with SQL Server 2008 R2 SP2 Express database or install application files only. This two of what does the two option means is, see, by default this option is selected, installing with SQL Server database. Max ERP supports SQL Server database from 2008 version R2. In 2008 there are two major lists by Microsoft. SQL Server is a backend that we are using for the software data to be stored. Now, all the customer informations and all the accounting transactions that we are seeing are being stored in a database at the backend. What is a database? It's a book. When we see multiple books in the software as we start, as we have created a book name called Max Enterprises, that book is at the back end is stored as an SQL Server database. A database is nothing but a group of Excel sheets, kind of tables it has, and each table will have rows and columns. Internally, it is all connected with each other. Each database, some database might have customer date, address information, some table might have. See, one database consists of multiple tables. Each table has different, each table you can consider to be like an Excel sheet, and everything will have different data. Some might have customer contact details, some might have the address details, some might have key contacts, some might have transaction, and finally the software is connecting all these different tables together and presenting the data in front of us in the Max ERP software. It is storing and retrieving the data from SQL Server database. All this data is being stored in SQL Server database. Max ERP is supporting databases right from SQL Server 2008 R2. That is the minimum database that is required for Max ERP software. If it's 2008, it will throw errors. So anything after 2008 R2, 2012, 2016, 2014 SQL Server, all this version will be supported, but the minimum requirement is 2008 R2. And we are using the Express database. Express is the free database that is provided from Microsoft company. We're using the free version only of SQL Server. So when we install it with the database, even the database will get installed at the backend. And see, for the Max software to work, there are three things required. The software is based on Microsoft.NET. It's been built on Microsoft.NET. So there's a .NET framework that is required. A .NET framework is nothing but a set of files based on which the software knows what screen to be presented, and that is the minimum dependency that is required for the software to open. Like we require a Windows on the system for it to turn on, for the software to turn on, it requires a .NET framework 4.0. This is the minimum version that is required for the software to run. If you do not have .NET framework 4.0, the software will not open. Okay, so even that is getting installed automatically as a part of this installation. So by default, you just have to click next and it will install the SQL Server 2008 database also. It will install in the default instance. At the back end, once SQL is installed, it will create a service at the back end in the Windows system.
Okay.
A service is something which is running at the background of Windows when the system is started. And all the communication to the database happens via that SQL Server service only. I'll show you where it comes. But once you click next, and then you can even see it's creating a shortcut, and you click next and it says start the Max ERP software after installation. We click next and we click install. So it is automatically extracting the required files and it will install the .NET framework 4.0, it will install SQL Server 2008 R2, and it will even install Crystal Reports runtime. What is Crystal Report runtimes? Crystal Report runtimes. So when we start the software, when we see the build preview formats, there's a print preview yesterday we have seen in another session. So when all the print formats that are coming from the software are designed in Crystal Reports. That's a separate third party tool. through which we are designing all these reports, and that is integrated inside our application. So for the CRISIL report to be shown or to be displayed inside our application, it requires CRISIL report runtimes. Like I said, Windows required, a system requires Windows OS in order to start. Software requires .NET Framework 4.0 to start. Likewise, for CRISIL reports to be displayed inside the software also, it requires CRISIL report runtime. Those files are also automatically installed in the setup. It says CRISIL report installation, it is automatically bringing .NET Framework. It is even bringing one folder like ctemp IES92 something is just shown.
Yeah, it was running.
So we can even, sometimes if the installation is not going properly, we can go to the temp folder and even extract those files. We can see what files were there. So I'm just going to %temp% and just open a folder saying IES90 and it has a folder called max files. So in this I can see what all is getting installed. CRISIL report runtime, CRISIL report RDC, .NET Framework 4.0 and few other files. Sometimes if the installation is not working properly, you have to open the temp folder like this and copy this entire max files folder, or you can even open the folder and copy the respective file that is required to the max ERP folder manually and then install them manually. Sometimes it so happens that while the installation, the .NET Framework 4.0 will not get installed properly. If it's not installing properly, you can open this temp folder, open this respective folder. See, this will be a random folder name which you'll see. In this we are seeing ISG90GV. This will automatically, it will create new folder with every installation. Under that you will find max files folder, and you have copied these three files in your max ERP folder itself. This is not required every time unless if there's any installation error, or if it's not installing the .NET Framework or CRISIL report, then in that scenario you will open this folder from the temp, copy the files manually and then install each of the file manually. Whichever is not working. If .NET Framework 4.0 is not working, you install this .NET Framework 4.0 only, and that is the only file that will be required.
Okay.
Right now it is taking care automatically. See, it is installing CRISIL report also, and now it has started extracting SQL Server database. It is getting extracted in IES R380H. You can see this.
Yeah.
So I'll again go back to this temp folder, and we see how do we copy it manually. So IES R3. And you can see SQL Server installation file here. So we can even copy this file to Max ERP folder only if it's not installing SQL Server properly. We need to go to the temp folder only when the installation is not happening properly. Otherwise, this temp folder access is not required. I've just shown you as a part of this training where we can even access these files manually. Sometimes if it's one of the files is not getting installed, instead of downloading it from internet again, we can open the software. We can just check which is the temporary folder. Yes, not every time. You cannot.
Most times it
will not throw any error. But if you get any error, how do you extract it from the temp folder? You have to check the name of the folder in this installation and go to start run %temp%, and then find that respective folder. Under that, you will find the required file. So by default, once you install Max ERP, you find two files here: Troubleshoot Max ERP and Troubleshoot Database.
Yes.
Troubleshoot Max ERP consists of, it's a package of .NET Framework, this CRISIL report RDC and CRISIL report runtime. All these files and few other files that we saw in the Max files folder, those all are packed in this file, and SQL Server is packed in this file, Troubleshoot Database.
So
even if sometimes Windows is getting formatted again and you need to reinstall the software, you need not download the Max ERP setup again. You just install Troubleshoot Max ERP. So this will install all the required files for the software to run, and Troubleshoot Database will install the SQL Server for the software to get connected with. Okay. So three important components of Max ERP setup is .NET Framework 4.0, CRISIL report runtime that we have seen here, and there's one more option saying CRISIL report RDC. RDC is nothing but report designer component. There's a possibility where we can alter the print formats inside the software. We can see the preview and then make the required changes if we want to make any changes in the format, font, logo, or we want to increase the size or change some alignment. That is possible only with this CRISIL report designer runtime. CRISIL report designer redistribution component. So clear with this three?
Yes, sir.
.NET Framework 4.0, CRISIL report runtime, and CRISIL report RDC. These three are required for the software to run, as well as for the report to be visible, and for CRISIL report editing also.
Yeah.
CRISIL report editing. Okay. SQL server is required for the database connectivity in the back end.
4.0 is also required.
What 4.0?
It has to have 4.0 version, it has to have SQL server.
4.0 is for the software front end.
Okay.
This 3 are for software front end. SQL server is the database which is called as the back end. Okay. So SQL Server 2008 R2, that is the version required minimum. So it will install the database as well as install this .NET framework, and everything will get installed automatically. You just have to wait for it to get completed. We are majorly using SQL Server 2008 R2 and SQL Server 2012. These are the two SQL Server databases that we are using for now, but everything above 2008 R2 is supported with MySQL. In 2012, Microsoft have even released a new option for SQL Server. Now, how an SQL Server works, we'll see that first, and then we'll jump into the other things. Whenever you install SQL Server, SQL Server consists of two parts. One is a database engine. Another is SQL Server Configuration Manager. SQL Server Database Engine and SQL Server Configuration Manager. Database engine is the primary, the background service that runs in the Windows, which helps us to connect to database. To make any minor configuration changes, like if we want the data to be connected from other parallel systems also, by default it will not allow the database to be accessed by any other system. Wherever we have installed it, there only it will allow to connect the data. But in Configuration Manager, we have an option through which, see, it has started the software automatically. We'll just see this. Immediately once you install the software, the first thing that you have to do is, you can just go with work in trial mode. And you need to update the software first. That is the first task that we have. So you can just go to options. How do you update for the software? So just click check for updates and give yes. Every time when we install the software for any client, the first time, after installing the software, first we have to do is check for updates. Then only we have to start creating with the books. If there's anything that needs to be done, only after the update. So it is just updating the software. This is an automated way of updating the software. Generally, all the clients will update the software this way only. They will go to options after the book is, in the software, once they start the software, they'll go to options and check for updates. So any new version that has come, it will get updated automatically and it will start the software after the update is completed. It will update all the required files, every update, whether it's GST or any print format changes, whatever you have done, everything will get updated here. This all process is automated, you need not do anything manually. But there's even a process where we can update the software manually. How to update the software manually, we'll see in this session itself after a while. So here you have understood how to install software,
yes,
and how to update the software.
Yes.
How to extract these files from the temp folder. Because this is not generally required, but if it's there,
yeah,
then you can.
There are options here,
but yes, but which folder will you open under the temp?
We can see what are the folders running there, and then
in the installation you'll find the folder name, and under temp you have to open that folder, specific folder,
yeah,
and extract the file. Sometime if the database is not installed correctly, you'll have to open it in temp file and you have to extract it. Let's say you forgot, or after an installation you got to know that .NET framework is not installed correctly. So what to do, now this is updated and we work in trial mode and we click proceed. So it says automatically this Dell PC and SQL Server 2008 R2 64 bit has been installed. There's no book created.
Yes.
Software is up to date. Now we are ready for new book creation. Book creation and other functional aspects we'll see in separate session. This session is specifically for installation and updating of the software and other features that we have here. I'll just close this for now. Now assuming, let's say, the things are not installed properly, either database or the Max ERP software, what do you do? So you will find these two files here, troubleshoot database and troubleshoot Max ERP. In case if you have not extracted the files from the temp folder, you can again right click these files and run as administrator. This is the same case which is even required for any reinstallation. If the system is formatted and you want to install the software again, you can come back to this folder. Instead of going to Max ERP setup, you can directly install these two files. That's all. You just have to right click here, click run as administrator and click next. Once you click next, it will start installation. Again, you'll find, see, it is extracting file to the temp folder 65AH8. So you can just go to percentage temp percentage IS65AH. In this, you'll find this Max files folder in which it is extracting the files one by one. Crystal report runtime. Then we have Crystal report RDC. RDC is for designing the report, designing the print formats. And then we have .NET framework. You can copy these files from here and paste in the Max ERP folder under the setup files folder. So this is the method that we follow. So tomorrow, if we want to file in the files again, we can go to the setup files and directly start with the installation. Here, same is the case with the troubleshoot database. If you want to extract the SQL Server database file manually and see what is the error that is coming in installation, this automated installation will not show you the error that is coming in.
Okay.
If you want to find out what is the exact error, why the installation is not happening, then you'll have to extract the files in the temp folder, copy the file from there to the Max ERP setup files folder, and then install the file manually to find out the error. Errors will come only in old versions of Windows. Currently with latest version of Windows, generally you won't find any errors coming in the software. Okay, so after this, you have installed this troubleshoot and this will get completed. And then you install troubleshoot database, even that completes and you are ready for starting with the software activation process. In case of system change or formatting of the system.
Reinstallation.
Even if you are transferring the software from this system to some other system, then you just have to copy this entire folder. In the new system, you have to install this troubleshoot Max ERP and troubleshoot database, and you can start. In a client system, when we have one server and multiple clients, when we have built, let's assume a client has 5 building counters.
Okay.
So clients or kind of systems need not require a database. They will just require a Max icon to be created on the desktop, linked from the server machine, and you just need to install troubleshoot Max ERP in that system. That's all. And the software will directly start running in the client. We'll see a scenario of the client also. We need to share this folder first in order for the folder to be accessible on the client system. Okay, we'll see the client system next. Now, what did we understand till here? For the Max software to run, the front end, there are three things that are essentially required. .NET Framework 4.0 is required. Crystal Report runtime is required. And for designing the Crystal Report, if you want to make any alteration to the print preview formats, then Crystal Report RDC is required. Crystal Report runtime is for displaying the print formats in the software. But if you want to make any alteration to the print format, then Crystal Report RDC, which is Report Designer component. These three components are important for the software to run. Second thing is in SQL Server, the backend. In SQL Server, the SQL Server 2008 R2 and 2012, which we are widely using now. 2008 R2, once you install the SQL Server engine, you will find two things getting installed. One is the SQL Server engine, which is a database service which is getting installed at the backend, which will run along with the Windows. As soon as you start the Windows, the SQL Server will start at the backend. The software is going to communicate to SQL Server engine, the service only. The service in turn connects to the data, fetches the data or stores the data. Okay. Even in case of a multi-user, the service stands in between and all the systems are connecting to the SQL Server engine service, requesting for the data, the service take care of the input and the output operations of the databases. Okay. So when we install SQL Server consists of three important components. One is the database engine, SQL Server Configuration Manager. This two comes automatically when you install the SQL Server database engine.
does it come with? It's just a configuration manager.
When you install SQL Server, it comes with two things. First is a SQL Server database engine, which is a Windows service. And second thing it gets is SQL Server Configuration Manager. Configuration Manager is used for us to set up different access to the SQL Server database. Basically, Configuration Manager helps us to set up access for the database engine. By default, SQL Server will not allow the software to be accessed from any other client system. If this is installed automatically, we have configured in such a way that it will even allow the client system to be connected. But in certain scenarios where we install the SQL Server manually, then in that scenario we have to go to Configuration Manager, do certain setting changes for it to connect. What are the setting changes? In Windows 10, for opening the SQL Server Configuration Manager, you need to, I mean, there's a different way to open it. Okay, I'll just show that part. But let's understand this one. Once you install SQL Server, two things gets in the backend. One is database engine, second is SQL Server Configuration Manager. Sometimes we even need a third component in SQL Studio. I mean SQL Server, that is called SQL Server Management Studio. Management Studio is a front-end interface. SQL Server Management Studio is a front-end UI through which we can access the databases whichever are connected in the SQL engine. How you can understand the SQL Server concept is, you can understand it in a way like a train. The database engine is like a train engine which is running at the backend. And then you'll have coaches which are nothing but the databases with the backend. So one engine can have n number of databases. Every book that we create in the software is a database which is connected to the engine. Software is requesting data to the engine, it will find the respective database and fetch the data or write the data in them. So something like train engine and the coaches which are connected. So if you have 10 books behind, 10 coaches will get created, assuming it's like a train. So 10 coaches will get created. All linked to one single engine. If you stop the engine, you will not be able to access any of the data. So when you install the SQL Server, the database engine is kind of a train engine, and every book that you create is like a coach that is connected to the database. Everything is connected to the engine only. Engine is the primary thing here.
It's like the brain.
Not the brain, something which is helping us to connect and read and write the data. So once we install the software, you find a Max icon coming on the desktop also.
Yes.
As well as Team will also get installed automatically once you update the software. So to open SQL Server in Windows, you just have to go to Run, or you can even search in your Start menu. Windows 10, the Configuration Manager will open with this command SQL Server Manager 11.msc. Once you open this, you can find, see, there's a database engine which is created called SQL Max 2008, Max 2012. And this is the default engine that is created. Now, as we have installed the software now, the default name would be MS SQL Server, which means there's no instance and there's no name connected to this, and that there's no engine name. The default engine name is MS SQL Server. Under Configuration Manager, you can even change certain settings for all this engine, like Max 2012. Max. This is the one which we have created now. For the software to access the database from the client systems, you need to enable all these three. So by default, in this installation, automatically everything is enabled. You can see here, this is not enabled. By default, when you install SQL Server separately, this is a manual installation which we have done for SQL Server. In this name pipe and TCP IP based access is disabled by default. You can just right click and enable those. Right click, enable, and click OK. And again, right click this also, enable. It says, see, you have to restart the service for it to be, I mean, the service needs to be restarted. So, okay. For it to become active, you go to services and you see Max 2008 and you right click and restart the service. By doing this, now the client system also will be able to access the SQL engine which is running in the system and access the data. In case of a multi-user license, this is the minimum thing that is required to be done for the client system to access the data on the server machine. Okay. How does a client system access the data on the server machine? We'll see two things here now. Now we have opened this data folder. So we have seen SQL engine which is getting installed along with the software by default is MS SQL Server.
Yes.
And then SQL Server Configuration Manager is also, we can start and we can do the settings for the client system to connecting.
Yes.
By default, all the settings or formulative for SQL Server Configuration Manager are by default installed automatically once with the Max ERP software. TeamViewer we are not even coming at. Installing the Max ERP software itself, automatically the configuration manager settings are also configured. TeamViewer gets downloaded automatically for the client to request support for. So they will have TeamViewer access on the desktop, they can open and run and directly avail support from our support team. So first we'll understand this. Now what are the three important components of the UI, the front end?
Front end has a
4.0.
What is
4.0? .NET 4.0. .NET Framework 4.0. That is the minimum thing required. Second?
It has to have SQL.
For the front end we are talking about.
Front end, it has to have .NET 4.0.
.NET Framework 4.0.
.NET Framework 4.0.
And also it should have crystal report runtime. For displaying the crystal reports, and the third is crystal report RDC, report designer component. This is for editing the crystal reports in the client system directly. If you want to make any changes to the print formats, then you can alter it only if the crystal report designer component is installed, otherwise it will not allow you to edit. And the backend in SQL Server, once we install SQL Server, by default two files will get installed automatically. One is SQL Server Database Engine and second is SQL Server Configuration Manager. These two will get installed automatically.
And it should be 2008.
2008 R2 is the minimum version of SQL Server that should be there with Max ERP. And third thing for SQL Server is the Management Studio. This is an optional thing, required only if we need to alter anything on the SQL Server Database Engine. It's basically a front end for accessing the SQL Server engine. Any databases, if you want to do any backup operations or we need to attach or detach anything in SQL Server, in that scenario we will require this SQL Server Management Studio. Management Studio also needs to be configured as part of systems 32-bit or 64-bit. So this will be available free in Microsoft website since we are using Express Edition. We need to find out whether system is 32-bit or 64-bit and accordingly download the required or respective version. If it's a 64-bit system, you need to download the SQL Server Management Studio 64-bit edition. Only then it will configure or it will get installed in the system, otherwise it won't. No, this is already there, you can find out in the system. You can just go to My Computer Properties and find out whether the system is a 32-bit system or a 64-bit operating system. If it's a 64-bit operating system, based on this, you need to download a 64-bit version. Anyways, we'll understand this while the practice of Management Studio. So till here we are clear. Installation of Max ERP software, you need to download it from the website. The website URL I'll just mention that separately. And front end consists of three parts. .NET Framework 4.0, that is the minimum thing. Second is crystal report runtimes and third is crystal report RDC. These three are important components for which the software crystal report designer RDC is also an optional thing, but all these three are equally important. And then we know how to extract the files from the temp folder in case if any of this file is not running or it's throwing any error, then you can install the file again from troubleshoot Max ERP file and you can find out from which I mean where it is extracting in the temp folder, then you can go to start run percentage temp percentage, open the respective folder, copy the file manually to the setup files folder. You can create a new folder inside Max ERP like setup files and paste it there for your future reference, and then install that file specifically. Let's say Crystal Report runtime are not installing properly or it's throwing some error, then you can install that file specifically again and find out what is the error, and accordingly if there's any error or if it's requiring a system restart, then you can restart the system and try again. Secondly, we formed the backend SQL Server database. 2008 R2 is the minimum thing that is required for us. Once we install SQL Server database, even SQL Server has 64-bit and 32-bit, so we need to find out respective version and download that. The default version which is available with Max ERP setup is applicable for both 32-bit and 64-bit. Once we install SQL Server, SQL Server engine will get installed and you will even find SQL Server Configuration Manager coming automatically along with the engine. When you see SQL Server engine, basically we just term it as which SQL Server, we just term it as SQL Server only. Where do you find that? So you go to services.msc. When you go to start run services.msc, you will find SQL Server coming here. So you find SQL Server 2008 and 2012 already installed. Now with this installation, even this installation has automatically come. MS SQL Server. So in case if you want to restart the services, you can just right click and restart. See, this has to be running at the backend. If I just stop this service, basically the engine will get stopped and you won't be able to access the databases. Okay. So sometimes when customer says I'm not able to find data, or if it's saying database configuration failure, during that scenario you have to verify this SQL Server is being installed correctly or the engine is running. How do you find that? You go to start run services.msc. In services.msc you find all the list of all the background services that are running. You find the respective SQL Server version which you are looking for, and that you should ensure that it is running.
MSCPC.
Services.msc. Start run services.msc. SERVICES.msc. Now next thing we'll see is how do we download SQL Server manually. Management Studio. So we go to maxerp.com. In this we will directly have a download support option. You can click this. In the support downloads, you'll find option for downloading AMI Admin, Show My PC, TeamViewer, as well as the option to download SQL Server Management Studio also. In case we have installed SQL Server 2012 and at the client side, you can install 2012 Management Studio. It's 2008, you can just click this 2008. It will automatically redirect you to the Microsoft website. From where you can just download. You click download and it will ask you what are you trying to download. Whether the database engine or the Management Studio would be in the name of at the bottom. It will show you Management Studio with a 64-bit. 86 is equivalent to 32-bit. So whether you want to install 64-bit means if your system is 64, select the 64-bit Management Studio and click next and download it. Once it is downloaded, we need to install the SQL Server Management Studio. What all can we access in the Management Studio? We'll just see a sample of it. After you download and install the Management Studio, you'll find this SQL Server Management Studio coming in your start menu. You can just open this. All this file can even be installed separately. .NET Framework 4.0, Crystal Report Runtime, and Crystal Report RDC. All these files can also be installed separately. You can download and install them separately, but by default it will be packed in troubleshoot, so you can extract it from the temp folder instead of downloading every time again and again. So once you come to Management Studio, it will say you which server are you looking to connect. So we are selecting the server name as, the default server name is Dell PC. When there is no, when we install the Max software automatically, it will just create the main system name itself as the engine name, the main server. See, in this there are three things connected. 2012 I have installed, 2008 has been installed, and the Dell PC is the main system name. The system name itself becomes the server name. and we can connect using either Windows authentication or SQL Server authentication. What does this mean? You can just select this Windows authentication and proceed for now.
You shouldn't take SQL again.
No, we can take. Authentication is for logging in. What authority? If you are administrator on the system, then you can use Windows authentication. Otherwise, you will not have permission to log in. Now, in the databases, you can see that no databases created yet.
Yes.
Once you open this plus sign, there's nothing available. Now, let's open the software once. We'll go with work in trial mode. And we will select it, we will create a new book. Okay, it's accessing and asking for the data. We'll just restore a data. If I have any existing data, I can just restore that. So let's say I just restore any data from. So this is created in 2012, so cannot be restored here. You can just select the structure and restore. What do you mean by restore data?
You're having some data already.
We are having a backup. We are bringing it back to the
position.
If you want to keep a copy of the data for the safety purpose, we want to transfer it to some other system also. We'll put a pen drive and we'll use backup option for backing up the data. Same way, we'll use the restore option for. If we have the data already, the latest data might. If we have some old data, then latest data will get overwritten. Since we did not have any data, one book has got created, and you can see the book would have come here, and you are able to see the Shubhashri database name is 1718. It has come here. At the back end, what has happened in the data folder? You will find two files that have come: Shubhashri 1718 and Shubhashri 1718 log. So whenever we create a new book, SQL Server will create a database, and database will have two files. One is the main file. Shubhashri.mdf. I mean, the main file extension will be .mdf, and there will be a log file which is extension is .ldf. MDF and LDF log database file. So every database of SQL Server will have two files at the back end in the data folder. By default, we create all the files in the data folder only.
Okay.
And two files will get created for every book. So now in the software we have one book, correct? In
yes.
The back end we have two files, one is .mdf and .ldf, two files with every book. LDF is a temporary, it stores all the temporary data there. It has an internal operation on how it stores the data for speed and other processes. But the .main in MDF file is having all the data stored primarily in that.
MDF is a main and LDF is a temporary.
LDF is a log file through which the transaction processing and some memory operations happens using that. But for you to understand, one SQL Server database will have two files. We term it as a book in the software, but one book at the back end we have database file name. So this is the database file name which is getting created in the database folder. Even though we create a new book also, it will be the same way. If we restore also, it's the same way. What happens on the front in the management studio when we see, you will find one book. If this refresh this, and you will find one book coming here.
Okay.
So with this engine, one coach has got attached. If we have 10 books, if we create a new book also, it will get linked here. If we have 10 books also, everything will be linked here. Now if I want to find something in Shubhashri, see in Shubhashri there are so many tables here. The account address, bank details, this detail, that detail, there are so many information being stored here. User permissions, masters,
so
everything.
Whatever
we are doing in the software details, it is getting stored here. Customers, vendors, inventory, stock levels. So basically this is going into technical aspect, but you just understand the basic level here. So everything is getting stored in this tables. Under Shubhashri database, everything is getting stored in the tables.
Yeah.
And there are certain commands in the backend through which we can do some sort of operations or optimizations in this database. For that, this management studio is required.
Okay.
In management studio, we have option where we can script out something, or I can just find out like select this commands, we will have a separate session on SQL Server commands. Some basic operations, because anything goes wrong here, that can impact your company data also. The commands is only to be used by professionals. But there's an option through which we can find out, like select count of star from account master. So this will give you all the number of, it says the 518 customers and vendors are there altogether. There are certain commands like this. But Management Studio is an interface for the professionals to operate something on the back end. Sometimes there are even chances where the data gets corrupted and it's not opening here. To rectify this data, we have certain commands which have to be executed in this Management Studio for it to get cleared. So the database will get rectified and auto-repaired and it will come back for usage. So clear with Management Studio. While installing SQL Server, it will ask you two things. Management Studio even has the second mode of logging in, saying SQL Server authentication. By default, SQL Server authentication will be, the username will be SA. SA is nothing but system administrator. And the password will be mbsmij@1234$. This is the default password that gets configured in SQL Server along with Max ERP software. This is the way through which the, even the client systems and the Max ERP software is connecting to SQL Server. It is using the SQL authentication and it will connect to the databases, and then you will be able to find everything. So in Management Studio, there are two ways to log in. One is Windows authentication and SQL Server authentication. You need not note this. Generally, we are using SQL Server authentication only. Just need to remember the username is SA and the password is mbsmij@1234$. Now, where do we find this in the software? In the software also, we have an options where we go to database and we have a configuration option here. We can click next. We can click next and find out which database is connecting to. So all these three database servers are listed here. So Dell PC is what we are connecting, what is the username, what is the password, and we click finish. And it connects to that particular engine and all the books of that engine are being displayed in the software. Understood?
Yes.
On that server, whatever is the database connected, which are of Max ERP, will get listed as a list of books automatically. There's one more additional option here saying use local DB. What is this? Once we click this, it changes all these parameters automatically. What does this mean? In SQL Server 2012, Microsoft has come up with one more additional option as a lightweight database. SQL Server 2012 and all this 2008, the installation files itself are very high and heavy. 2012 installation is almost 150 MB and Management Studio is around 1 GB. So to avoid this, I mean to create a lightweight database, they introduced one option in SQL Server 2012 only. From 2012 onwards, LocalDB has been introduced. LocalDB is a concept where there is no engine running at the back end. Automatically, all the files are getting created in the data folder and the software directly reads and writes the file. Rather than communicating with the SQL service on the SQL server and then communicating through it, it will directly reads and writes the files in the data folder using LocalDB. For that, LocalDB needs to be installed. So there's a separate installation option available on the website where you can find, see, SQL Server 2012 LocalDB SP1. If you click this, using which you can download the LocalDB file. LocalDB also you need to verify whether it's 32-bit or 32-bit or 64-bit, and download the respective file and install in the system. After you install LocalDB, you even need to configure .NET Framework 4.5. That is a compulsory requirement for LocalDB connectivity. Whenever you configure a LocalDB, you even need to install the .NET Framework 4.5. That is the minimum requirement for LocalDB connectivity. Okay. And once you install that, you can use this use LocalDB option and you can click finish. It will start interacting with the data in the data folder as a single, I mean directly as a database file in the data folder. The book will not be available in any Management Studio anywhere else. It will not connect to any engine. It will directly read the files in the data folder and start updating or reading and writing from the data folder. The only disadvantage with LocalDB is it is in a single user mode. When there's only one system, or I'm using my software in a pen drive or in one single system only, then I can use LocalDB. But if I want four systems to be connecting to the same server parallelly and do the data entry and read and write operations, in that scenario, LocalDB is not useful. It will not help any other client connect to it. Only when the same system in which I am accessing the software, that can only read and write files in the local DB. Since there's no service involved, other system cannot even read or connect to anything in the system for reading and writing the data. So local DB is basically a single user database, a lightweight database. For local DB installation, you need to download the local DB file from the Microsoft website, either 32-bit or 64-bit accordingly, and you will even have to download .NET Framework 4.5.
But when it does not be sharing, what is the use of
technology
locally?
If someone is with a, I mean, I'm having a small business and one system is sufficient for me, then I can use local DB itself instead of SQL Server. I'm having only one system,
so
small business.
Branches
either branches or multiple systems are there, in that scenario, you have to use SQL Server 2012.
Okay.
Now, SQL Server upgrade and degrade also. There's something called the 2008 R2 database can be opened in local DB or it can be attached to SQL Server 2012. But once if you have connected 2008 database to 2012, you cannot take that data back to 2008 because version update happens.
The highest version.
Whichever is the highest version, if you open the data in the highest version once, you cannot go back to the older version.
Mm-hmm.
So basically 2008 data can open in 2012, 2012 data cannot open in 2008.
Mm-hmm.
Same way 2014. Data, it can open 2008 also, it can open 2012 also, but this once it is upgraded to 2014, you cannot open it back in 2012 or 18. So reverse degradation of databases connectivity is not possible. So by default, everything is getting created in 2008 R2. And let's say we have upgraded the data to 2012 now. We install SQL Server 2012 engine and connect the data there. It will automatically upgrade the database version. And again, if you want to revert it back to 2008, that will not be possible. Local DB 2012 onwards only have been introduced. So 2012 local DB database, tomorrow from a single user, you say, no, I want to access in 5 systems. Then you can install SQL Server 2000 engine, shift the local DB database to the SQL Server engine, and you can access in multi-user. That is a possibility available. As well as 2012 database can even be shifted back to local DB also. Both local DB and SQL Server 2012 are having the same versions. It's SQL Server 2012 local DB or SQL Server 2012 database engine.
See, suddenly there are four systems, you are using four systems, suddenly you are telling me that they are taking a separate system as the main system. Can I take it back like
that? Yes, you can do that. We'll just summarize this part of SQL Server now. SQL Server consists of three components again, two are the primary. Once we install SQL Server, the database engine gets installed as well as the configuration manager gets installed.
Yeah.
We need to verify whether it's a 32-bit system or a 64-bit system and download the respective version, both of database engine as well as the management studio.
Yeah.
Management studio is an optional setting, optional software that is required. Usually we will install that software in the server machine for any sort of database, direct database command operations. And in Management Studio, you generally log in using the SQL Server authentication with the username and the password. Username will generally be SA and the password, if it's a default password, it will be MBSMIJ81234$. Both M will be in caps. We'll have this password in the software, that's not an issue. And users can even change the password if they want for the SQL Server logging in. SQL Server Configuration Manager is used for setting up certain changing settings for the SQL Server database to be connected from the client systems, or maybe even from a mobile app also tomorrow, because the setting is involved there. Even if you want to connect your mobile app to active data directly from SQL Server, it will require some settings to be configured in the configuration manager. These are the three important parts. Apart from this, in 2012, Microsoft introduced SQL Server 2012 as well as SQL Server 2012 Local DB. Local DB is a lightweight database. Only disadvantage is it is in a single user mode. And local DB requires .NET Framework 4.5 to be installed, otherwise software will not be able to connect to data local DB database. Local DB database is directly in the application folder, it just reads and writes the file directly from the data folder. Rather than contacting any other engine in between, it will directly read and write the files in the data folder. Only disadvantage is it's in a single user mode and multiple users cannot access it. This was with SQL Server. Now we understood how to install software,
yes.
How to troubleshoot the software by going to temp folder, how to install SQL Server database, how to install Management Studio, and we will even learn how to update the software also has been learned.
Yes.
how do we manually update the software also we can learn now. So for updating the software manually, generally the client system, there's an auto backup setting also which is running. So after once it closes, it will take a backup automatically. I just force it close now, so that every time you close the software, it will take a backup automatically.
Delete this, can we delete this?
What?
Delete this.
For deleting this, you'll have to go to management studio only. Directly you cannot delete. You can only detach by default. So in order for the software to be updated manually, for our backend team, we'll have one file called max all files.
Okay.
Check for updates is an option where we connect the system of the client and we go to options and do check for updates, automatically it will update. Sometimes we even have a necessity where we have to update the files manually. And customers cannot do this, but for our backend team operation, we'll have this file in our systems where we can just copy this file or transfer this file over the team via to the customer system, where we will transfer under Max ERP tools folder, we will transfer this file. So once we transfer this file on the team via, you will find a zip file coming here, Max all files.
Okay.
You can right click this file and click WinZip extract here. So it will ask you, do you want to override all the files? So in this game, yes to all. It will override all the files. So once it overrides rest, we will require this file to be in the root folder. Max.exe, the main file, should be again cut and paste in the Max ERP root folder. This file has to be overwritten here. So that might have multiple files. Max all files might have many files in it, but all the files will be into tools folder. And only the main file we have to cut back from the tools folder and paste it here. This has to be overwritten here.
Mm-hmm.
Because the file software will start from here only. Just other files will be there in the tools folder. Tools folder will consist of so many other files based on where the software runs and does different kind of operations. Okay. So how to update the software manually? Transfer Max all files from your system, the latest version of Max all files from your system to the client system over TeamViewer under Max ERP tools folder. In tools folder, you will extract all the files and override it there itself. You will give extract to here. Inside the tools folder, you give extract to here. It will ask you to override. Override all the files and cut max.exe, the blue color icon file, from the tools folder and paste it in the root folder. So this file only needs to be overwritten in the main folder. This is how is the manual update process. Automated update, if it's not working, this is the way you do a manual update. Now you will even understand the max folder application folder structure. What is there in the backup folder? See, once we install the software, automatically all these folders will get created. You'll even find this troubleshoot database and troubleshoot max ERP file coming automatically. Backup folder will have a date wise folder created. Every day it will create a new folder. Under this folder, it will create a backup every time you close the software. So if you have closed software 5 times, all the books backup will come multiple times with see, even the backup files has a different naming standard. It says Max ERP 2017, 10th month, 07 is the date, 11 and 18. 11 hours, 18 minutes, 37 seconds. 37 seconds, this is the database file name. And for our reference again, it's a 7th October backup. So we can quickly find out. If you close the software, open the software again and close it, you'll find one more new file will come here. Likewise, every day it will create a folder for 30 days. After 30 days, the oldest folder will get deleted, the new folder will get created. Each folder will have the backup file. As many number of times you have closed the software on the server machine, that many files will get created. Basically, once you close the software, auto backup will happen in the backup folder under that current date folder. Okay, with that date and time. I open and close it now again. In today's date folder, you'll find the second backup. You'll find the second backup. And all this backup will be there for 30 days. It will keep a rotation, it will keep a log. Data folder will have the direct database books which are there. How many of books you have created? These are the database which are directly connected to the SQL server. Error log will have a set of screenshots. If there's any error coming in the software, it will automatically take a screenshot and keep it in the error log for our reference purpose. Tomorrow, and it will even send that screenshot to the developers automatically in the backend. In case if you send any report, the developers get a screenshot with the details and the error that is there on the screen, and based on that they can quickly rectify the issue. Files folder will consist of all the attachments that we do. Product images, customer user images, yes, any documents that you have scanned or any document that you have attached, all that will get stored in the files folder. Under files folder, it will create for each book a separate folder, and that will store the files. Layouts folder will have the different screen settings and the screen layouts. Anything relevant to the software screens, we can hide certain columns in certain screens and do certain changes on the screening part, and we can save that. So that screen related layouts will, when screen changes will get stored in the layouts folder. You can just go to any report in the software and you can remove certain columns and save the setting. So next time those columns will not be visible. But once you save that setting, it will get stored in the layouts. Let's say, assuming it's the sales register, you have date, column, city, GST number, gross total, gross amount, expenses, net amount. If you hide city in gross amount for reducing the width, and you can save that layout, the setting will get stored here. Next time you open the sales register, those two columns will not be visible.
But we can see it in the system.
No, if you want, you can again change the setting and make them visible.
Okay.
Reports folder will have all the crystal report files. Anything which is related to the print documents.
Mm-hmm.
Anything which is relevant to the crystal reports will be under the reports folder.
Okay.
Either it's a dot matrix printing also. The print layouts, print tables, vouchers, receipts, payment, invoices, thermal printing, POS printing, certain ledger reports, statement, confirmation statements, anything which is related to the Crystal report or Max report designer, the dot matrix reporting tool, that will get stored in the reports folder. Barcode design format will also be in the layouts folder only. When we design a barcode, even that format will get stored in the layouts folder. Setup file is just we have created for our purposes, where we just store this file from the temp folder.
Mm-hmm.
So this is we have created manually, it is not an automated folder. Temp folder will be automatically created, it will have certain temporary files for the software to operate.
Okay.
Like any email that we send with attachment, the attachment gets created in temp folder. It will attach, send the mail and delete the attachment automatically. So temp folder can be even deleted, so nothing will be there as such in temp folder. It will get auto cleared. Then we have tools folder. So for the software to operate, when you are seeing so many themes and so many options on the screen, everything is connected with so many options here in the back end. There are multiple tools. One takes care of automatic backup, one takes care of some notification pop-ups, one takes care of automatic updates. So there are so many tools. Certain tools which are starting from Max are all designed by us, and other names which are already there are certain libraries available for different kind of operations. TeamViewer is also available here. We need not understand the details of each of this tool, but everything together works. It's all linked together. That is why we are able to see that software interface screen, and we are able to see the different preview. Whatever options that we are seeing on the screen is based on these tools. The main file connects with these tools, and then only it is able to present all this data in front of us. If we delete the tools folder, the software will not open. Apart from .NET framework, which is required for the software to open, even these tools are also equally important, because based on this only we are able to see the graphics that is there on the screen, the options that here, the menus, the options,
okay,
everything is there on the screen is based on these tools.
Okay.
Certain tools we have designed on our own, certain tools we have the predefined libraries based on which all the structures are being displayed. So this is the Max folder architecture. Basically in the Max folder, you'll even find one more folder called local backup. This, if I start the software now, you'll find that local backup folder getting created automatically. So this is an icon also which has come for Max ERP local backup. What happens with local backup? Every half an hour, see this folder is got created.
Uh-huh.
It will create current folder, and every half an hour it will keep taking a backup. Every half an hour, one more extra backup. Only to the extent of the work that has happened in that half an hour. First backup is a full backup for
yes.
complete data, and then in the next half an hour or next 1 hour, whatever you have done the task, only that small backup will happen.
After
it will keep taking backups every 1 hour.
Okay.
Just for extra safety purposes.
Well,
this will be there for 5 days. This is more than sufficient. 5 days, every half an hour backup will be there. What is the purpose? In supermarkets and all, the transaction volume will be very high. And every time when you give full backup, it takes a lot of system resources, it will slow down the system. So the first backup happens, and then every half an hour or every 1 hour, only the transaction that has happened in that 1 hour, that will get backed up. Tomorrow at one point, if the system is getting corrupted, let's say it has got corrupted by afternoon 3 o'clock. So we can restore file right from the morning, which is having the complete backup, and then every hour backup up to 3 o'clock. Up to 3 o'clock we can just restore the backup from here itself. Or something is went wrong around 1 o'clock and you want to check only till 1 o'clock, then you restore up to 1 o'clock, and remaining 2 and 3 o'clock you can just ignore that backup and find out if it's working correctly. But this is the folder structure of Max ERP software. I'll just close this. So we have learned automatic update, the manual update of the software, how do you manually update the software. Then you have even understood the folder structure of Max ERP software. Next thing we will learn is how to connect the software in a client system. So how do we connect a client, software in a client system is, to do this we need to first right click the software. No, when the software is already installed on the server machine, after that we just need to link to the client systems. For configuring the software in the client system, you have to go to properties. You have to right click the Max ERP folder, go to properties, click sharing, and you have to go to advanced sharing. You have to click the share this folder. Under permissions, you have to give full access. And you give OK. Once you do this, the second thing even you can do is, you have to go to security. You can click edit here. You can add a new role saying everyone. And select all permission for it. And click OK. So now by this, we have given the full sharing permission and full access permission to all the users on the client systems. Okay. On the client system, now everyone will be able to access this Max ERP folder by going to My Network Places. Once you go to My Network Places on the client system, you need to enable this network discovery. You will find this Max Desktop, Max Dell PC, and you will find Max ERP folder under that. You can open this folder. First thing you have to do is you have to just right click this file on the client system. First we are doing the sharing on the server machine, and then on the client system we are going to My Network Places. In that we are opening the system, the server system which whichever is the server system in which Max ERP is installed. And then the shared folder of Max ERP, we are just opening that folder. Under the folder we will find the Max icon. So we just right click this icon and click send to desktop. This is step one. So you will find an icon of Max ERP software on the desktop of the client system. Step one. Step two is, you just right click this troubleshoot Max ERP and click run as administrator and click next and finish. So it will automatically install .NET Framework 4, run Crystal Report runtimes and Crystal Report RDC and other required files. Database, troubleshoot database is not required on the client system. Database is only required on the server machine. Okay, I repeat, database is not required on the client system. Troubleshoot database should be there only on the server machine, because that will be the database engine there. It will connect to the database engine and finish off. So once troubleshoot Max ERP is installed and you have the icon on the desktop, by that you will be able to directly start the software and run on the client system. That's it. So this is the way we are configuring the software on the client systems. So tomorrow, if we have any client who says I want to configure or connect the software to one of my client system, they should have a multi-user license of the software first. Secondly, after installation of the software on the server machine, you need to share the folder with full permissions on the server machine, and then go to the client system, go to My Network Places, select that particular server machine. Under that you will find the shared folder of Max ERP which you have shared on the server machine. After that you have to right click the Max icon, send to desktop, so you get an icon of the software on the desktop. And secondly, right click this troubleshoot Max ERP and click run as administrator. And after you click run as administrator, you have to click next and wait for the installation to complete. Once the installation is completed, the software is ready to get started on the client system. Okay, so this is all with Max ERP setup, installation of SQL Server databases, local DB which we have understood, 32 bit and 64 bit. Along with that, we need to install .NET Framework 4.5, which is a compulsion, and SQL Server Management Studio is required only for the front-end operations, that is generally be required only on the server machine, not on the client systems. And we even learned on updating the software automatically as well as manual update. Plus, we have understood the folder structure, what is being stored in each of these folders in SQL, in Max ERP software. Plus, in the database, you have different books. Each book is a database file which is connected to an engine. And each book will have two files. Basically, a database will have two files, .mdf and .ldf. And we even understood how to share the folder on the server machine with full permission. Even provide everyone, even in the security, give full permission for the everyone user. And then on the client machine, we go to My Network Places, select the server machine PC. Under that, we'll find the shared folder of Max ERP. In the folder, we'll just right-click the Max icon and click Send to Desktop. So it will create a shortcut of Max software on the desktop, directly linked from the server machine. Plus, we'll right-click the troubleshoot Max ERP and run as administrator on the client system. So this way, even the runtime soil that is required for the software will get installed. Troubleshoot database need not be configured on the client system. It's only required on the server system. Then on the client system, we can directly find the icon and double click and run.
Client system and server system. Client system is the client who's serving it. Server is the main thing.
Server is the main system in which the database is stored.
The client space.
If the client is having five systems and he wants to build on the all the five systems, means one of the system will be a server and remaining all will be clients, and all the data will be stored only in the server machine. If the server system is not running, client will not be able to access the software. But if everything is running, then all five will be able to access all the data centrally real time. Okay, so we'll end with the session for this. Thanks a lot.